Well, hello Internet, and welcome to part 4 of my Learn to Program tutorial. In this part of the tutorial, we're going to focus in on even more string functions and how they can be used to solve very, very complex problems. If you haven't watched any of the previous parts of this tutorial, you definitely should, and I provide a link to those in the description as well as on this video, and also in the description there is a transcript as well as all the code used in this tutorial. And I have a lot to do, so let's get into it. Okay, so a whole bunch of you guys asked me to use a dark sort of theme in this tutorial because it would be easier to see. Please tell me in the comments if this looks better and if I should switch back to white or what I should do, because I do everything you guys tell me to do. So what I'm going to do here first is I'm going to create a string, and on purpose I'm going to throw some white space in front of it. Written string like this. And then I'm going to have a whole bunch of functions do things to this string. So I'm going to say random string is equal to random string. And then if I want to get rid of that extra white space on the left, I just type in lstrip exactly like that, and that'll be gone. And likewise, I can get rid of the white space on the right side by just putting rstrip inside of there like that. Or I could just put strip inside of there and it would get rid of all of the white space on the left and the right. Stripping white space is very important, and as you program further, you will learn that it is important and you'll use it all the time. Another thing that we can do with string functions is capitalize the first letter, and I can come in here and just do a print with random string and then follow that up with capitalize, and that's exactly what that'll do for me. And you can go and run this, and you can see right there that it capitalized that, even though this was lowercase over here. We're also going to be able to come in here and make a string uppercase, and that is very useful, and you're actually going to see an example of how that is useful in this tutorial. We can also come in and set it to lowercase. And an example of how this would be useful is if you don't want to worry about converting from lowercase to uppercase and so forth and so on whenever you're comparing strings. Like I said, that's very useful, and you'll see an example of that. And you can also see on the right side of the screen how this is capitalized and this is lowercase. And oh, by the way, if you're wondering how I went and moved the code from the bottom over to the right, I just right-clicked on it right here, and then I went down here to move to, and then I changed it to right from the bottom. Right's not on there, obviously, because it's on the right. Another thing we can do is turn a list into a string and separate the items with a defined separator. So I could come in, and the next part of the tutorial I'll get more specifically into lists. But basically, it is just a whole bunch of pieces of data that are going to be indexed, sort of like we do with strings. So we could say something like bunch of random words. And then to convert those into a string, we could just come in and say print. And then you would have how you want these things to be separated. So I'm going to say I want all of these items in the list to be separated with a space. And then follow that up with join. And then inside of here, you are going to pass in the list. And if we run that, you can see a bunch of words prints out. Whoops, I spelled words wrong. And you can see exactly how that works. Likewise, we're going to be able to easily convert a string into a list. So let's come in here and we'll go a list 2 is equal to, and I'll go and do my random string again. And if I want to split those up, that's exactly how that's done. And then of course I could come in here and cycle through all these items in my new list, and we'll just do a list 2 for this, and then we can print out all those different items, and you can see exactly how that worked over there. Another thing we could do is count how many times a string occurs in a string. So let's just go and call print for this, and I could say something like how many is's are there in this string, something like this. And then we can call random string and count, and then specifically what we are looking for. So if this is the guy, it's going to count this as an is and this as an is, both of those as is's. You can see we get 2 back from that result, or for that query, or whatever you want to refer to it as. We can also get the index of a matching string. So we could say something like where is string, and then call our random string again, and we would then use find, and then specifically what we're looking for. You can see it starts at index 21, It's only going to return the very first string that we're searching for inside of there and the index for that very first string. And we could also come in here and replace a substring with a substring. And how we would do that is go random string again, and then we're going to call replace. And then let's say, for example, one I want to replace is an, and I went and threw a space inside of there, with a kind of, like that, with a space inside of it. And then you can see right there it comes back. This is a kind of important string instead of printing in just simply this is an important string. So there's a whole bunch of new functions that we're going to be able to play around with. And now I'm going to jump into our first problem. Okay, so what I want to do now is create an acronym generator. And by acronym, I mean if you would type in something like random access memory, that would be in acronym form, RAM. So that's what I want you to make. So what we're going to do is allow the user to enter a string, and then using these new functions we learned about, I want you to convert that string or that grouping of words into an acronym, and I want you to also convert those to uppercase letters, exactly like I did here with RAM. And that should be enough information, but if you want a hint in regards to the structure of this, we're going to do something like ask for a string, and then the next thing we're going to do is convert the string to uppercase. Next thing that we're going to want to do is convert the string into a list. We then want to cycle through the list, and then inside of that, as we're cycling through, we want to get the first letter of the word and eliminate the new line whenever we print out to screen. So see if you remember how to do that with the print function. And then the final thing that we want to do is to add a new line, and see if you remember how to do that from previous parts of the tutorial. So pause the video and figure that out, and then come back and see if you got it right. All right, so asking for the string, what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to go original string is equal to, and we'll do input, of course, and I'll say something like convert to acronym. Then we need to convert that to uppercase, and you saw exactly how to do that before. We're going to do original string, and then we're going to call the upper method in, or function. Anytime I say method, just you can think of that as a function or function as method, whatever. Then I want to convert the string into a list, so I'm going to call this list of words. Boy, why am I spelling words wrong today? List of words. And I'll call original string again, and then we can call split on it, and it's going to split everywhere there is a space in the string that we are working with. And if we want to cycle through our list, we could say for word in list of words. We want to get the first letter of the word and then print it out the screen while eliminating the new line. So we can just call print on that. Get the very first item inside of there. That's a zero index. And then if we don't want a new line to show up, we just type in end and then put nothing inside of there. And then, of course, to add in our new line, we just call print again. And if we run that, whoops, indentation error on original string. Well, where's that at? Oh, wasn't that silly? I was going and putting an indentation here for some weird reason. Let's get rid of that. Let's get rid of that. And let's just get rid of that whole thing. Tab that in. And then this one is perfectly fine. And it says convert to acronym. And I can type in random access memory and hit R. And you can see that RAM comes back right like that. So hopefully you got that right, and if not, that's not anything to worry about. Now I'm going to jump over and cover some more string functions, and then do a really complicated example or problem that you guys can solve to learn more about problem solving and getting better at programming. Okay, so for our next problem, some additional methods are going to be very useful. So let's first off start off here by creating some strings. So I'm going to have letter Z is going to be equal to just a character Z. And then I'm going to go number 3 is going to be equal to, and then I'm going to put a 3 inside of there. And also space. And then inside of here, I am going to put just one space. Now, what we're going to be able to do here is call different functions that are going to tell us the type of data that we have inside of our string. So, for example, we can go and find out if the string letter Z is going to contain characters and letters. So, we can easily call a function to find out if the letter Z string up here contains only characters and numbers, or letters and numbers. So we could say something like, is Z a letter or number? And then get a result from that by just taking the letter Z and calling is all num. And let's go and copy this because we're going to use a similar format a whole bunch of different times. We're also going to be able to find out if it is only a letter, which means it's going to come back as false if it contains numbers or spaces or any other different symbol. And how you do this is by calling isAlpha. We could also check if a series of characters in a string contain only numbers. However, this isn't going to work for floats. If you put a period inside of there, that is going to come back as false. I'll correct that and show you how to create a isFloat here in a second. So we could say something like is3 a number? And here we can just put the num3 inside of there. And then we can come in here and change this to digit. We could also come in and check if lowercase or uppercase are being used. And that's going to be used in our last part of our tutorial here. Big giant problem that's coming up. So is Z a lowercase? And to find that out, is all we have to do is go is lower. And then we can also come in and check if it's uppercase. And here we'll just say is upper. And then finally, we could also come in and check is space a space. And this is going to work for any type of white space. And we'll just throw a space inside of there. And then just change this to space, exactly like that. And if we run those, you'll see is Z a letter or a number comes back as true. Is Z a letter comes back as true. Is 3 a number comes back as true. Is Z lowercase true, uppercase false, and is space a space comes back as true. Like I said, if you would come in here and let's just change this from number 3 to 3.14 and we'll run that. Now you might look at that and say, well, that's definitely a number. Well, you can see here it comes back as false. So how could we come in here and actually create a isFloat function, for example, so we can check to see if something indeed is a float? Well, we can do that, no problem. And here I'm going to create our very first function. I'll get more into lists and functions in the next part of the tutorial, but I think you're definitely going to be able to understand this. Now, a function is just going to allow us to avoid writing repeated code, and it's also going to allow us for structuring our program so that it is very easy to start referring to blocks of code with a name versus blocks of code with just great big giant long lists of code. So it makes it easier to understand our code and also avoids repeating code. And whenever you create a function, you're going to start off by typing in def, and then you're going to type in whatever your function's name is going to be. And then if your function receives any attributes or values that are passed into it, you're going to put those inside of there. And let's say that you have another one, you're just going to separate that with a comma or something else. Okay, but we're just going to keep it simple. It's just going to return, or it's going to receive one string. That's what our function does. And then if you want to check if a value is going to be a float or not, one thing we could do is use exception handling. So we can come in here and we could say something like try to convert the string that was passed into this function into a float. Now, if it can do that, we can return true, knowing that indeed this string value was a float, just like this one right here is. If, however, we have an exception occurred, well, in that situation, we know that we have a value error, meaning that this cannot be converted into a float. And in that situation, we will return false. And you won't have to do anything in regards to changing anything else here. And you can also see here how our functions are able to return values directly to whoever called those different functions inside of our code. And then if we want to call our function in this situation, we can just say print is pi a float. And then we could call for our function to execute just by going is float. and then passing in num. And if we run it, you can see is pi a float comes back as true. So there is a way for us to check if a string value is indeed a float and how to solve that little problem we had right there. All right, so now it's time for our final problem, and this one's going to be a little bit more complicated. What I want you to do is implement what is known as Caesar's cipher inside of a program. And the way Caesar's cipher works is you're going to pass a message that you want to be encrypted. And how we're going to encrypt characters is by shifting them a certain amount. So for example, if we were going to shift the A 3 spaces, all the A's would become D's. Likewise, if we were going to shift the B in that situation, the same 3 spaces, all the B's would become E's. And remember from previous parts of the tutorial that A through Z using Unicodes are going to be represented with the numbers 65 through 90 inside of Unicode, and lowercase a through z are going to be represented with the numbers 97 through 122. Also, if you don't remember, you're going to be able to get the Unicode for a character just by typing in ORD followed by whatever your letter is. Likewise, you're going to be able to convert a Unicode into a character by calling CHR and then whatever your code is or your Unicode is. Some rules for creating this is that you should check if a character is a letter, and if not, just leave it as default. So if it's a space, do not change it in any way or try to shift it into a letter, just leave it as a space. Likewise for any other different symbols, and you have the functions here available to you that are going to allow you to be able to check what all the different characters are. And if you think you're up for it, you can jump in, pause the video, and create it. Otherwise, I will provide a couple more hints. So here's a couple more hints here if you want to make sure that you have the best chance of getting this right. Whenever you're creating this program, you're going to want to use isUpper to decide which Unicodes to work with, because this is going to work with uppercase as well as lowercase letters. Also, you're going to want to add the key, which is going to be the number of characters to shift. So you're going to want to ask the user for the number of characters you should shift. And if the key is bigger or smaller than the Unicode for the different letters A, Z, lowercase a, or lowercase z, you're going to want to increase or decrease by 26 to stay within the range that we're defining up here with the uppercase letters here and the lowercase. And I think that's probably enough in regards to hints to help you along. So once again, you can pause the video, try to write the program, or I can provide you with even more hints just to make sure that you can do this. Another set of hints here is I'm basically just going to walk you through the program and exactly how I would create it in text form. So what we're going to do first is we're going to receive the message to encrypt and the number of characters to shift, and that's going to represent the key for us. You're then going to need a place to store the secret message. So we'll just say prepare the secret, let's just call it secret message. Next thing is you're going to want to cycle through each character in the message. And cycling, of course, means you're going to use some sort of looping function, either a for loop or a while loop, more than likely a for loop. You're then, like I said in the hint, check to see if it's a letter or not. So if it isn't a letter, then keep it as it is. You're then going to get the character code and add the shift amount for the key. Then, if uppercase, then compare to uppercase Unicodes. Then, if bigger than Z, you're going to want to subtract 26 from that. Likewise, if smaller than A, add 26. And that's just because there's 26 letters. Likewise, you're going to come in here else if it isn't uppercase. You're going to do something very similar. So we'll say do the same for lowercase. And then after you have that all set up, you're going to need to convert from code to letter and then add to your final secret message. And then you come to a situation in which this isn't a letter and you want to be able to handle that. So we'll say something like, if not a letter, leave the character as is. And then you're going to want to print out your message to the screen. Then I could actually, because what I did right here to convert it into the secret message, I am going to do the absolute opposite to convert it back to the original message. What I should do is create a function, but because we haven't dwelled that much on functions, I'm not going to do that right now. So it basically means I'm going to give you a prime example of why functions are useful by forcing myself to type in the same code multiple different times. And as extra homework, after you finish this part, using exactly what we have here, jump in there and try to figure out how to streamline your code based off of what you do know about writing functions inside of Python. But before we get to that, to decrypt, the only thing that changes is the sign of the key. So you're just going to use the opposite of the key that you used for encrypting to decrypt. And then, like I said, everything else that follows, the same as above. So you can, once again, pause your video to see if you can write this code out based off of the hints that I just provided you. Otherwise, I'm going to come in here and actually just start writing some code. All right, so the very first thing we're going to do is get the message from the user, and I'm sure at this point you know how to do that quite easily. Just ask the user for a message that they want to encrypt. Then you're going to have your key. We're going to convert that into an integer and, of course, call for input on that. And then we'll say something like, how many characters should we shift? And it's very important that they don't do any more than 26 because that's all we have to work with. So we'll just put 1 through 26 inside of there. Okay, so we have our message and the number of characters we want to shift. We want to prepare our secret message. And we'll just type in secret message and have that contain nothing that we will add to as we create the rest of the program. We're then going to cycle through each character in our message. So we'll just go for character in the message that they passed inside of it. Then we want to check if it's a letter or not. And we can do that with if character and then call is alpha. And that, like I said previously, is going to allow us to work with it if it's a character. And if it is not a character, then we're just going to use whatever it was previously. Tab inside of here. Then we're going to get the character code and add our shift amount to it. So to get our character code, we just call ORD on the character to convert it into a character code. And then we're going to add our shift amount to it. So there, that works. Now, if we are working with an uppercase, we want to come in here and check if it's uppercase. So if character is upper, so I told you those functions are very useful. Well, then we want to check if it is bigger than 26 since we added the key amount onto it, or is bigger than uppercase Z or the character code for uppercase Z. And to do that, we'll just go if character code is bigger than ORD and then throw the capital Z inside of there. Well, since we already added the key to it, we can just jump in there and subtract the character code by 26 to throw it back into the space where it's supposed to be. Otherwise, if it is smaller, we can just copy this guy right here, throw that inside of there. Make sure you keep all your white space exactly right. And here what we're going to do is we're going to say less than, and then we'll change this to an uppercase A. And then in that situation, we have to add 26 to that. And then you're basically going to do exactly the same thing if you're dealing with lowercase letters. So we'll come down here, make sure that this if here is going to line up with this else that we have here. And that'll tab in. And then what we're going to do is we're just going to copy this and paste that inside of there. And then we'll copy this guy right here. And we will paste that inside of there. Like I said, make sure the white space lines up. And then all we need to do is change this to a lowercase z like that, and change this to a lowercase a like that. Well, now that we have those letters all set up for ourselves, we're going to be able to add these to our secret message. Make sure you tab in here to where the else is. and we will call secret message, and then add in the new converted character that we're dealing with. And we're going to have to convert it back into a character by passing the character code into CHR. But remember, we also have the situation in which this is an alpha or a non-alpha character. So we're going to throw an else statement inside of here. And remember, we're just going to keep all the characters that are not letters, whatever they originally were. So the spaces will stay spaces, and whatever other codes will remain whatever they were. So here we'll just type in else, and then here we'll type in the secret message once again, and we will just replace this with whatever the original character was. So we can get rid of that. And then at the end, now we know that everything has been encrypted, so we can just print out in encrypted, and then follow that up with our secret message. So that's how we go and encrypt all that. And then everything here is going to be exactly the same, except the key is going to change. So let's just get rid of this here. And also, let's take this print and throw it over there. So we need to basically, to decrypt it, we're going to go and assign key to the negative of whatever the key is. That's how easy it is to convert everything back. We're then going to create our original message that we'll be adding to as we cycle through. And then basically we're just going to come up here, and right here where we have four characters in message, let's go and grab all of that right down here where it has the encrypted part, and then we'll paste this inside of here, and then we'll make a couple little different changes. We're still going to come in and check if it's a letter or not. And everything else is going to be the same, except we are going to replace all the secret messages with original message. So just cycle through here, and there's a secret message right there. So let's change this to original message right here, and we'll change this to original message right here, and we'll change this to decrypted, and then we'll change this to original message. And there we go. And if we run it, it's going to say that we want to enter our message inside of here. So we can come in and say, make me secret. How many characters will we want to shift? I could say something like, oh, I'm just always bothered whenever I have things misspelled inside of here. So let's come in. How many characters should we shift? And there's 26 inside of there. Put that little space inside of there. And we'll also throw this inside of here. All right, so enter your message, make me secret. How many characters should we shift? Let's type in 4. And didn't get the results I was expecting. Let's look and see if we can figure out why we didn't. Okay, so if we look at this, we're shifting 4 spaces. So we're going to take the M and we're going to go N, O, P, Q. Okay, perfect. That shifted all right. Now if we're shifting back from Q to the M, we're going to go 4 spaces back to the left. So the Q should go 4 spaces back to the left and go P, O, N, M. That should look right. Uh-oh, but now I see where the problem is. If, however, we would start from the M, meaning the original message, and then shift it to the left 4 spaces, now we see our problem. What I did here is I went and basically encrypted it by moving backwards 4 spaces. So let's look at our code and figure out exactly how we can solve that. Well, you can see right here, this is going to be secret message. This is what I wanted to convert. Now, did I convert in my copying and pasting madness? Let's come down here. There we have original message. And there we see our mistake. We went and tried to decrypt the original message. So what do we want to really decrypt? We want to decrypt secret message. Now let's go and save that and see if that went and solved our little problem right there. Run it, enter a message. Make me secret. How many characters? 4. And you can see right there that it was able to work. Okay, so hopefully you guys enjoyed that tutorial. And like I said, for homework, I want you to put the duplicate code into a function and have that work for you. And if you have any problems with functions, in the next part of the tutorial, we'll cover functions and lists. So please leave your questions and comments below. Otherwise, till next time.